और सेकंड यू कैन से रिसोर्स पर्सन मिस्टर के यू धनकाचन जी एंड ही इज डायरेक्टर मार्केटिंग राष्ट्रीय केमिकल्स एंड फर्टिलाइजर्स लिमिटेड. ही इज पोस्टेड एट मुंबई एंड वी ऑलवेज यू कैन से हैव बीन गेटिंग फुल सपोर्ट फ्रॉम हिम. ही डिलीवर्ड ए लेक्चर इन आवर एनुअल सेमिनार ऑन लॉजिस्टिक्स ऑफ फर्टिलाइजर्स एंड ही इज ए लर्नर्ड मैन. I don't want to take much time. May I request Mr. Thankachet ji to kindly take us to the journey of important aspects of key areas of logistics of fertilizer. And this logistic, my dear friends, it play a very vital role. Always you can say keep, you can say in mind the key areas of logistics of fertilizers by Mr. K.U. Thankachet ji. Thankachet ji, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Yadav. Yeah, thank you, Dr. Yadav, for the introduction. So he has given a very comprehensive, brief about the marketing aspects of fertilizers. Now, what I am going to focus is on the logistics aspects. So logistics, briefly talking about logistics, it is the management of flow of goods from the production point to the point of consumption. So this logistics can include inbound and outbound transportation. It can be inventory management, how you are stocking the products, then the fleet management, warehousing, materials handling, packaging, then the integration of information and other value-added services. In this context, sometimes we talk about supply chain management also. So basically, so supply chain management is referring to a wider concept where you have because if you're in a manufacturing kind of a setup, we have multiple partners, we have suppliers, we have vendors, we have the customers. So the entire chain is made up of a large number of organizations which are providing transportation, which could be supplying you the raw material, and the call centers which are attending to the different needs of the customers, maybe some warehouse providers, so on and so forth. So this is a much more wider concept where you are in trying to integrate all these different aspects into your business through probably enterprise resource management system or something like that. So that you, there are many organizations, particularly in the auto sector, which are, which want just-in-time supplies. There these things can be easily monitored if you have an enterprise-wide network or a supply chain management different supply chain management system. Now, in our case, case of the fertilizer sector, as we know, a lot of it is controlled. And the logistics is, primarily the transportation is more or less dictated by the government under the FCO. And you have a supply plan almost every month. Hello, yeah. Supply plan almost every month, which is prepared by the Department of Fertilizers. And we are asked to, send the material to different destinations as per the supply plan. Now, if you, in a very simple manner, if you were to look at logistics, it is having the right item in the right quantity, at the right time, at the right place, for the right price, in the right condition, to the right customer. So these are, mentioned as the 7 R's of logistics. It, gives you a very brief idea of that. I mean, we would ideally like to have all these things put together when we are doing our logistics, but it's not always in our hands, right? So the more efficiently we are able to purchase and transport and store the raw materials and cut down on the inventory costs, cut down on the logistic costs, we'll be a much more efficient organization. Our productivity and our performance, our profitability, all these will go up substantially if you are able to control these costs. And that is why logistics, efficient logistics is very important in our system. Okay, now the goals of logistics, it is represented in this diagram, you can see what are the objectives. One is that you have a better freight economy. You should be able to reduce your costs in freight. The product quality should be consistent. We should be able to reduce the transit time, because the more we are able to reduce the transit time, we are in a better position to serve our customers. We should be able to reduce the inventory, and then we should be able to provide some amount of value addition also through this. You know, when you talk in the Indian context, what we generally, you know, it is generally stated in many seminars and conferences that our logistic costs are quite high in comparison to the other developed countries like Germany, USA, Japan, France, Korea, and so on and so forth. So this is almost 14% of the entire cost is logistics cost. And this is attributed to a lot of efficiencies in our, you know, the transportation sector, in warehousing, in IT services, and so on. So our the government also would like to, you know, reduce this logistics cost, towards which there are a number of measures which are being taken. Internationally, they say that, you know, a 0.5% decrease in the logistics cost can lead to about 2% increase in trade and 40% increase in the range of products that are exported out of a country. So any attempt at reducing this logistics would be welcome. Now, if you look at the overall Indian logistics environment, we would say that primarily, you know, railways, shipping, roads, aviation, warehousing, these are the basic components of the logistics structure. And railways is the primarily a major carrier of particularly bulk commodities, because nowadays railways, you know, does only mostly rake load movements only. And you would find, you know, the bulk commodities like coal, food grains, fertilizers, cement, all these kind of products, sugar, all these kind of products are carried through the railways, and it is an environmentally friendly kind of a transport. And it is now, it is accounting for about 26% of the total freight. They're carrying over 1 billion tons of freight annually. Then, of course, the shipping, as far as shipping is concerned, there are 13 major and 187 minor ports, which are handling about 95% of the country's foreign trade. In terms of value, this is 70%. But what you will see is that, you know, in the aviation, it is totally different. In the aviation, it is only 2% of the logistics movement. But in terms of value, it is 30%, because it is high value cargo that is going mostly by the flights. And as far as roads are concerned, we have about 3.83. I mean, it's a huge network. It's the second largest in the world. It is carrying about 85% of the passenger traffic and 65% of the freight. And as far as warehousing is concerned, they're also we are lagging behind substantially in various sectors. And but it accounts for about 5% of the Indian logistics market. You know, as far as the fertilizer sector is concerned, India is very critical, because you have seen from the previous presentation also, we are, you know, India is the third largest producer and consumer of fertilizer in the world. And a substantial element of imports is also taking place to supplement the, you know, the whether it is for raw materials or whether it is for actual finished products, we are also a large importer. So in the international context, we are really much looked up to kind of a country. And because it's there's a lot of consumption taking place in India, the growth is taking place, the substantial growth is taking place this year itself. In the last year, in spite of the COVID conditions, we have seen that, you know, the growth is to the tune of almost 15%. And agriculture is the only sector which has performed really well. We have huge stocks of food grains, and there's a lot of procurement taking place in India. This is fertilizer was a sunshine sector as far as these difficult, you know, period was concerned. And India is second in production and consumption of urea after China. It is third in production and second in consumption of phosphates. As far as MOP is concerned, India is solely dependent on imports. That is for KCL, is we are totally dependent on imports. And India is the largest importer of rock phosphate and phosphoric acid. India is also among the largest importers of urea, DAP, MOP, ammonia, sulfur. So in all aspects, I think India is leading in across the. Now to talk about this complexity of this supply chain. Now let us consider that, in the past year also, you would when you take into account the total requirement of fertilizers, the sales of fertilizers is over 600 lakh metric tons. Now, out of that 600 lakh metric tons, you can say about 70% is produced within India. That is about 420 lakh metric tons is produced within India. And the rest, about 180 lakh metric tons, is brought in by way of imports. Now you can imagine, if you 600 lakh metric tons means it would be about 20,000 rakes, railway rakes, assuming everything is by carried by rail, and assuming about 3,000 tons in a particular rake. So you can say that about 20,000 rakes are being are required throughout the year, and the average requirement per day would be about 50 to 60 rakes. So you can very well understand the importance of railways in the entire logistics requirement. And as you can see from the screen, there are about 172 fertilizer plants which are spread across the country. There are 31 urea plants, about 19 DAP and NPK plants, 111 SSP, 10 ammonium sulfate, and 1 ammonium chloride. This is the production side. As far as the states which are producing, Gujarat, Uttar Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, Maharashtra, and Odisha are accounting for about 70% of the production. Now, many of these fertilizer plants are located near the coast purely for the reason that raw materials are largely imported and there is easy availability. So the cost of transportation of these raw materials would reduce if you are next to the coast. So as I said earlier, its imports is to the tune of 30%. And there are 24 major and minor ports where these fertilizers are being handled. The fertilizers are required to be made available to about 739 districts in 29 states, and roughly 935 rake points and 7,000 blocks across the country. So this is the complexity, and sale has to be effected through about 3 lakh retail shops, which are in, it could be in the cooperative sector or in the private sector. And we are targeting over 13 to 14 crore beneficiary farmers. Another important aspect of this complexity is that this consumption is seasonal, but production and imports, it's a process industry. So the production has to continue throughout the year. So we have to move these products irrespective. We cannot store large quantities within our factory or plant sites. So we have to move this out invariably, and this has to be moved out. So if it gets moved out, what happens? It has to either go to the warehouses or to the godowns of the dealers and the retailers, so that the as and when the consumption, there are basically two seasons, as you know, Kharif and Rabi. So Kharif would be stretching from June to May, June to maybe August or so, and Rabi would be from October to December. So during these 2 3 months, the entire consumption is taking place, and we have to see that the product is available at the destination points. And it is sufficient stock is available so that as and when the consumption peaks, immediately we are able to disperse these products to the ultimate beneficiaries. Okay, this is the supply chain features. As we all know, this raw material procurement is a very key aspect, and this can be either imported or locally if it is available, well and good. So production is taking place on a daily basis. It's a process industry, so this cannot stop. Then there are import coming in and from the through the ports, and dispatches are taking place by rail, by road, and by in some cases by coastal movement to the district warehouses, to the wholesalers, and then in turn from the wholesaler it goes to the retailer. And then finally, as you all know, the until and unless the product is sold at the retailer point through the POS machine, we will not be able to realize the subsidy. There's a we are selling the in the case of urea, we know that almost 25% to 30% is the MRP, and the balance almost 70 to 75% is to be collected at the time of actual disbursal through the POS machine with the acknowledgement from the farmer. Then only we are able to realize the 75% subsidy which is due from the government. There also, if there are difficulties in budget release of subsidy, again we would be stuck for some time. So there is always a delay in the period up to which we are able to realize the full amount for the product that we are manufacturing today. Now this is again the supply chain, which is from the plants and the ports, the rail movement and the road movement is taking place. This movement, which goes up to the rake point or to the destination by road, is called as the primary movement. And so this primary movement basically is up to the rake point, and from the rake point again, it has to be moved by road to the various godowns of the Marketing Federation or wholesalers and so on and so forth. So that is actually taking place by inside the in the trucks, that is called as the secondary movement, and then from the retailers on to the farmers. As I told you earlier, 70% of the total consumption of fertilizers. So, assuming big chunk of 600 lakh, we have about 425 lakhs. That is about 70%. That is production, and 30% is the import. That is 184 lakh metric tons. Now, this is again these figures. Also, Dr. Yadav had shown this to you. So as you can see, about 425 lakh metric tons of fertilizer was produced in the last year, that is 2019-20. And every year there is a growth. Last year also there has been substantial growth. This year also there is growth taking place in the production. So out of that, urea is about 56% or so. 57%, that is 244 lakhs. And next is NPK. NPK production, that is about 93 lakhs. That is about 20%, you can see. And DAP production is 45 lakhs. That is about 10%. And SSP production is again 42.5 lakhs. So that is again roughly 10%. Now let us look at the plants. Where are these plants located? Urea, primarily the urea plants. There are 36 straight nitrogenous plants, out of which 31 are producing urea. Major urea plants, as you know, EFCO has their plants at Kalol, Amla, and Phulpur in UP. CRIPCO has their plants in Hazira, Shahjahanpur. NFL have their plants in Vijaipur, MP, Panipat, Nangal, Bhatinda. Chambal has in Gadepa and Kota. RCF has the plants at Trombi and Thal in Mumbai. And GSFC in Baroda, GNFC in Bharuch, Nagarjuna in Kakinada, BVFCL in Assam, Zuari in Goa, MFL in Chennai, Yara in Barwala. So these are the major plants, urea plants, which are operating in the country. These units are together producing around 244 lakh metric tons of urea in the last year. And new projects again, which Dr. Yarol mentioned, NFL in Ramagundam, that's shortly being inaugurated. Metix Durgapur is also likely to get operationalized soon. HURL, there are three projects at Sindri, Gorakhpur and Barauni, which are in the pipeline, and probably by end of the year or so, it should be operational. There's a TFL project, which RCF is also part of in Talcher. And there's another project which is still in the works, which is yet to be finalized, BBFCL Assam. So these together, these new projects together should be providing around 60 to 80 lakh metric tons, which currently, you know, we are importing. You can say that we are last year we imported around, this year we have imported around 100 lakhs already. So if these new plants come, I think our import dependency will get reduced to a substantial extent. Now, these are the DAP and complex fertilizer plants in India. There are 19 of them, which includes NP and NPK also. So which are the major ones, just to, you know, have an idea? There is IFFCO is having at Kandla and Paradeep, and the Coromandel at Visakhapatnam, Kakinada and Ennore, RCF at Trombay, GSFC at Baroda and Sikka, GNBFC at Bharuch, Zuari at Goa, MFL at Chennai, MCFL at Mangalore, and FACT at Cochin, so on and so forth. So these units have produced around 45 lakh metric tons of DAP and 93 lakh metric tons of NPK in the last financial year. Now, this is about the All India, All India imports of fertilizers. Last year, we imported around 184 lakh metric tons, out of which 91 lakhs, almost 50% is urea, right? And then substantial amount of DAP is there, 48 lakhs. Then MOP was around 36 lakhs and NPK relatively less, 7.5 lakhs. But this year, those NPK imports have almost doubled to 15 lakhs. Based on the country of origin, the urea, you can say the primary countries are Oman, China, and Egypt. Oman has a project, you know, OMIFCO, which is providing substantial amount of urea. This is in collaboration with IFCO and CRIPCO. And China, of course, is a major exporter of any fertilizer. And Egypt is also. And other countries include UAE, Indonesia, CIS countries like Russia, Ukraine, and so on and so forth. As far as DAP is concerned, Saudi Arabia and China are the major exporters. SABIC is one of the, you know, major companies which are in production of DAP. As far as MOP is concerned, this CIS countries, these are the Russian, you know, countries which have split up after the breakup of Russia. You would see like something like, you know, BPC or Uralkali, which are the major suppliers. And then Canada and Jordan are also supplying MOP. And as far as NP and NPK, again, it comes from Russia, China, and Indonesia. Then these are the primary suppliers. Russia is the primary supplier. Now, as far as sales is concerned, again, this just shows you the share of various products. Urea, of course, is the highest sale. Commands almost 55.4%, and then followed by DAP 17%, NPK almost 16%, and MOP is hardly 4.8%, SSP is 6.9%. Now, the products. These are again sales figures. Last year, as I told you, 605 was the total figure. 605, these are in lakh, okay. In millions, it would be 60 million tons. So this year, we hope to end up around, I think, 660 to 680 lakh metric tons would be the total sales. So there's a substantial jump in the sales this year due to many favorable conditions. So I've already shown you the slice of the share of various products in this sales. And this again is representative of the dispatches, which again, roughly on the follows the same pattern, because the entire amount produced and sold would be more or less similar to the dispatch. So you have around 600 lakh metric tons, which needs to be. This is where the importance of the logistics here. You can see, about 5 years back it was 540 lakh. Now we are going to touch maybe 660 lakh. So every year the requirement for enhanced logistics is increasing. And this is the share of the various products, which is roughly equivalent to the other like sales and production and so on and so forth. Now, as far as raw materials procurement is concerned, the rock phosphate is available in some areas, but it's a very limited quantity. Rajasthan, MP and West Bengal, the indigenous reserves are there. So last year production was only 8.7 lakh metric tons, and we had to import substantial quantity. This is 5 lakh metric ton had to be imported from countries like Jordan, Morocco, and Egypt. Now, as far as ammonia is concerned, it is partially met through imports from Saudi Arabia, Qatar, Egypt, Indonesia, etc. So last year, the figures were in the range of 26.4 lakh metric tons. Then phosphoric acid also, we are dependent on imports from Morocco, Jordan, Tunisia, USA. So this is the raw material for DAP and NPK products. Last year, 25 lakhs was imported and 16 lakhs was the local production. Sulfur also is being imported to the tune of around 12.35 lakh metric tons from countries like UAE, Abu Dhabi, Qatar, etc. Now, this is a natural gas that is, chemically it is methane, CH4. This is the primary raw material for production of urea. So here again, what I've tried to show you is the pipeline network, and this pipeline network is about, it is owned by various companies like GAIL, Petronet India Limited, IOCL, ONGC, and this is about 17,016 kilometers long now. So you can see the various the networks which are available, and as far as about 40% of this natural gas requirement is from the local fields. And balance is RLNG, that is regasified, liquefied natural gas. So these are coming in cryogenic tanker vessels, which are maintained at minus 120 to minus 170 degree centigrade. So when it is in liquefied form, they are able to transport larger quantities of the gas. And these tank, there are various RLNG, points, collection storage points at various ports within the country. And the 30% of this LNG is coming in for fertilizer production, and balance for power generation and various other requirements. But fertilizer industry is a major consumer as far as LNG is concerned. This LNG terminals are operational at various places like Dahej, Hazira, Dabhol, Kochi, Ennore, Mundra. And this is transported in the pipelines to the various fertilizer. And you must be aware of the concept that concept of pool pricing. Because LNG is available at various prices, whether it is in the spot market or whether it is in the long-term contract, so there are varying different ranges of prices, starting from $1.75 right now for the domestic administered APM gas, as they say, it going up to $30 and so on and so forth under various and it. There are substantial variations. For instance, in the just recent past, there was a huge hike in the prices of the natural gas because both in US and Japan, severe winters are happening, and therefore the demand for natural gas in those places is shot up substantially. So we find that natural gas prices are varying from, so all the fertilizer companies have to pull in and pay a common price which is determined by the department. So that's the pooled gas mechanism. Now, if you look at the supply chain of fertilizers, again, I mean, that diagram is representative of how it is happening. And the logistics cost is coming to around more than 50% of the total marketing cost of fertilizers. So the costs include the rail, road freight, the storage cost, handling cost, then various rebates, you know, incentives which you give, and the inventory cost, which is also quite high because we have to store fertilizers over a longer period of time. This is just a general representation of the various logistic costs. Within the, you know, the logistics itself, there is transportation, there is packaging required, there is warehousing and handling required. There are losses at various, you know, from handling and or from spoilage, rain damage. So there are losses happening like that. Then inventory carrying is also a cost as far as fertilizer is concerned. Now, the various modes of the fertilizer transport are primarily in India, it is primarily railway and road, and coastal shopping to a rather limited extent. Now, as I told you, railways is the major carrier as far as fertilizer is concerned, and it has a very huge network, about 67,415 kilometers, and 80% of the share of the fertilizer movement is taking place through the railways. And for any movement by rail would be deemed as primary movement from the plant or port to the rake point. And the primary freight by rail is fully reimbursed as per the allocation by Department of Fertilizers. And maximum permissible lead by rail is generally restricted to 1400 kilometers. Of course, I mean, it is entirely dependent upon the department to allocate other destinations also with longer leads to you. Then the rakes which are being deployed in the circuit, normally there are two different types of rakes, and these are box end wagons or no, BCN wagons or HL rakes. And BCN wagons would be about, these are closed wagons. And this BCN would be having about 42 wagons, and HL would be having 58 wagons. The capacity also, there's a difference in the capacity range. That is, BCN wagon is 2,600 metric tons, and HL wagons can be 3,200 metric tons. So these are the wagons which are mostly being allotted for the fertilizer movement. Now, as I told you earlier, there's a, you know, seasonal variations which are happening. So there are peaks in the middle of Kharif and Rabi season. So nowadays you would find that, you know, the relatively the requirement is lesser even for the you know, fertilizer companies, but there is, the department would be pushing you to move rakes from the ports to the destination. So because what is now happening is mostly placement. So what the fertilizer companies are doing is actually, you know, sending the material to the dealers, to the dealer points, and placing the material in the possession of the dealer or the retailer with the advanced credit and so on and so forth. So that, you know, some, at least, you know, substantial chunk of that material is warehoused so as to meet the sudden requirement which is likely to come up from the beginning of the Kharif season, that will maybe May, June, and another 2-3 months. Which would be the peak as far as Kharif season is concerned. Now there are, you know, there are a lot of issues which we also face as far as the rail movement is concerned, because at many locations, you know, we don't have, the railways doesn't have adequate facilities or covered godowns are not there. So during the rains, enough protection is not often available. So you would find that, you know, part of the material gets damaged through the soaking in the rain. And the many of the godowns are having limited storage facilities. Labor is, labor costs are very high at the rake points. Handling costs are very high. Every year there are, you know, the contractors keep on hiking the handling charges. So we are not able to realize those amount. There are always under recoveries in as far as handling and warehousing, the transportation from the rake point. All these are concerned. Many of the fertilizer companies are facing that problem of under recoveries. Then very often, you know, if the rakes are detained for some reason or the other, demurrage and wharfage charges are levied by the railways to charge to the costs. So if you look at the share of the rail movement over the years, in 1980, 1981, you would find that, you know, rail movement was only 67%. And the balance is moved by road. You know, so over the years, I think for the last 5-6 years, it has been steady at around 80%, because the most of the movements are now being routed through rail, and only 20% movement is done by road. Now, as far as roads are concerned, yes, road network is also quite large in our country. There are over spread over 3 million kilometers, and the national highways are about 72,000 kilometers. There are a lot of development taking place. New roads are being constructed, new highways are being constructed. Now, as far as here again, the primary movement up to 500 kilometers can be by road, for which the DOF has prescribed some, you know, notified slab rates. So whether it is even from the plant or from the port, you can do primary movement by road if it suits you. If the distance is very, very quite small and the, you know, trucks are available, you can do the primary movement through rail, which is, but the only catch is that, you know, it is not fully reimbursed. So you may be incurring more cost. So you should be able to you know, take that under recovery into your costing considerations. For the P and K fertilizers, the freight reimbursement is on actuals, subject to maximum of equivalent rail freight as per the goods tariff. Movement by road from the rake point up to the retail outlet is termed as secondary movement. Again, this is based on some notified leads, and the rates are also notified. So everything is restricted to those components which have to be approved by the Department of Fertilizers. So there are some you know, normative rates which are notified by the department from time to time. The policy allows for escalation, but you would find that these rates have not been revised in the recent past. And there again, it leads to under recovery. As far as P and K fertilizer, like DAP or MOP or whatever, NPKs, there is no reimbursement available for secondary movement. So therefore, whenever you fix the MRP for that product, you will have to factor in this, you know, the fact that, you know, secondary movement is, has to be borne, cost for secondary movement has to be borne by the fertilizer company only. So that is why you would find that there's a lot of variation also in the case of MRPs and discounts and rebates which are being offered by the fertilizer company, particularly for the NPK and DAP and PNK products. Road transport, again, there are several challenges. You will find that most of the truck operators are in the unorganized sector. Sometimes there is a risk of diversion, theft, and frequent revision and charges, and so on. Now look at the ports. This is a diagrammatic representation of the major ports. As I told you, there are 130 plus ports. There are 13 major ports in India, but only 24 ports across the coast are being used for handling fertilizer imports. So you can see that, you know, I mean, Kandla, Mundra, so on and so forth. So all these products, these are rather familiar ports to most of us. So you would find that, look at this chart, you would find that, you know, Kandla is handling the highest amount of fertilizers, that is 35 lakhs out of the total of 184 lakhs, 35 lakhs was handled in Kandla. Mundra handled about 34.7 lakhs, then Kakinada handled 20.22 lakhs, then Vizag, Pipava, Krishnapatnam, Gangavaram, these are the major ports which are handling the fertilizers. Here again, you will find that, you know, as far as imports are concerned, there are two different things. One is that, you know, RCF, for instance, is a state trading enterprise, and along with MTC. And we have been given the mandate to import the urea on behalf of the Government of India. So the entire process, starting from NIT and formation of NIT, global tenders.
Then sir, 5 minutes only. Nankachan, sir.
Okay.
5 minutes only, sir.
Okay, I'll try to finish it. So that is, STEs are there. Then apart from that, you know, the handling agency at these ports are also nominated by the Government of India, again through a tender process. So you would find that, you know, all these IPL, NFL, all these companies have their own ports for handling the products. And they use it to, you know, distribute the urea from those locations. Again, coastal movement is also one of the recent introductions. Here, the it is supposed to be more cheap and environmentally, and the shipping ministry estimates that about 70 lakh metric ton fertilizers can go through coastal as well as inland waterways. Such movement is, I mean, hardly, I think only a few companies are doing it. Maybe IFCO and FACT have done some transportation in coastal vessels. This movement is taking place primarily in containers, 20 feet containers. So a 20 feet container can carry around the 24 to 27 metric tons. And the beauty of containers is that, you know, it can go by multiple modes. It can go by rail, it can go by road, it can go by vessel. And without any, you know, damages or loss to the fertilizer being carried, the containers can be shifted from one place to another through a crane, which can be used for handling the containers. So there are several advantages to movement in containers and coastal vessel also. Apart from coastal movement, there is also inland waterways. So this shows you a map of the major important waterways. And among the important one is NW1, which you would, you know, from Allahabad to Haldia, connecting from Allahabad to Haldia. And this is a major Indian water route. Then another one is NW2, which you can say it is on the Brahmaputra River and going through Bangladesh and on to Guwahati, and further up to Dhubri, north of Assam. So that's NW2, and NW3 is some, you know, canals in Kerala, and NW4 is in Andhra. So you can broadly see there, but there are over 130, 111 notified waterways. But these are the major waterways which are now partly being used. It's not a very you know, stable kind of a system even now because of various constraints. So as far as considerations in you know, when you're selecting the mode of transport, what would you look at? You would look at transit time, you would look at the cost, you would look at the predictability and the availability of the you know, the mode of transport, and various non-economic factors, So, but cost and transit time are very critical. So warehousing is also very important now. As far as warehousing is concerned, in India, the warehousing industry is highly fragmented, and there are almost 90% players are in the unorganized sector. In as far as fertilizer is concerned, various agencies like government agencies also like CWC, state warehousing corporations, MARCFED, cooperative societies, and various other agencies in the private sector are providing warehousing for the storage of the fertilizers. So what we would find is that because of the seasonal requirement and limited availability, warehouse space is often found to be blocked with fixed quantity around the year. And this is again an area where we need to minimize the cost, and if we need to improve the profitability for the company, we need to ensure that warehousing is rather limited. So in many cases, you would find that our sales team also would like to remove the material from the platform itself fully. I mean, it will move on to the dealers or to the retailers, so that minimum inventory is kept with us. Now, as far as handling is concerned, bagging is mostly mechanized in the ports and at the plants. We are using mostly SDPE bags. So proper packing and labeling is critical because there are penalties which are being imposed by Meteorology Department if you do not follow the norms or the particular format that is required by the Meteorology Department. Handling at the ports and plants are mechanized. But you will find that when it comes to the rake loading, rake unloading particularly, that at the destination point, it's mostly done by manual labor. And there are chances of spoilage and handling by hooks and so on and so forth, which can damage the material. And now to conclude, I'll just talk to you about various developments in logistics, what is actually happening on the ground in other sectors. Of course, as far as our sector is concerned, it is still rail and road logistics. And we also have a highly integrated system, that is IFMS, which has high transparency as far as our products are concerned. So we know where the material is at what point of time, and how it is being moved from one party to another. But in the global context, even within India, there are several new things happening. There are automated handling and warehousing which is taking place. Palletization is taking place, which is with the forklifts we are able to move a large quantity of the cargo. So that mechanization is taking place in a big way. What we are doing is actually inefficient as far as the handling at the railway rake points is concerned. It's highly labor intensive. So even in the plants, so there's a lot of labor which is involved. So the world is moving towards mechanization. Then there's a lot of tracking of the cargoes which are taking place through, whether it is through RFID, whether it is through GPS monitoring. There are several technologies available for tracking and finding the actual movement which is taking place. Robotics has come up in a big way, so it is replacing manual labor. And you have Amazon warehouses which are just practically functioning on very, very limited labor. And this again is a big data analytics. That is something which is again taking over the warehousing industry in a big way. Of course, we as far as the IFM is concerned, it's a huge repository of data. But we should be able to see, the patterns and the trends, the regressions, what is happening. So the system, through big data analytics, we will be able to identify and see up to the micro and at the macro level what trends are taking place, how the fertilizer marketing and sales, all these things are happening. So big data analytics is another totally different term. Where again we are, I think, lagging behind to a large extent. Artificial intelligence, you know very well that a lot of technologies are available for whether it is in the field of agriculture And similarly, in the field of fertilizer, also lot of developments are taking place where the artificial intelligence is giving predictive inputs. Blockchain for digital transactions, here again, a new field which is developing where all the transactions can be, I mean, commercial transfer, particularly for commercial transactions, there is total, you know, security, because each data is secured through blocks at each level. Then in the field of logistics, not just the normal warehouses, now you have multimodal logistics parks, carrying, I mean, which are capable of handling any kind of commodity, and there are private freight terminals, which are again, you know, are capable of handling bulk commodities also. They have silos which are coming up for storage of the bulk commodities. The railways is going into dedicated freight corridors where the freight, double decker kind of, you know, containers can be stacked in two rows, one over the other, which will substantially increase the capacity of the railways. And the freight, the speed also has come down and has gone up substantially, which means transit also, we will have easy transit, much more faster transits across these corridors. Bulk silos for storage is taking place in a big way in food, in the case of food grains. FCI has moved into this. Whether it can be done for the fertilizer sector, that also we need to look into. Of course, containerization is something which is very essential. That flexibility also should be there for the fertilizer sector to move in containers. But again, here also a lot of issues with related to subsidy needs to be ironed out. E-commerce is another area where the again a lot of things are happening. And now the latest that we are seeing is that many public sector companies are also being you know, put on the privatization annual, and we have to wait and see how these developments are going to take place. So this is broadly my, you know, take on the logistics as far as this fertilizer sector is concerned. If there are any questions or anything, I'll be happy to answer. Thank you.
Thank you, Thanka Chenji, for taking us to the journey of key areas of logistics of fertilizers. And my dear friends, there is one, you can the chat box. You can write your question. We'll send that question to the learned faculty, and you will get the, you can say, response, get the reply. Thanks a lot, sir. Thanks a lot, sir. Because you are getting a little bit late.
Yeah.